Good morning, everybody. I'm Kate Seeley with the Middle East Institute, and thank you so much for joining us for today's book discussion and signing with BBC's North America Bureau Chief, Paul Danahar, who will be discussing his book. I don't really need to hold it up since it's everywhere, The New Middle East, The World After the Arab Spring, published this year by Bloomsbury Press. Today's event is part of a series of book signings that MEI has been doing to mark the launch and renovation of its library, the Oman Library at the Middle East Institute, which, if you haven't checked it out, please do. It's in the back in a carriage house through the garden. It's open to the public from 9 to 5 every day and contains 19,000 volumes on the Middle East, most in English, 400 rare books, and it's a real gem here in the heart of DuPont Circle. And if you like it, if you want to hang out and relax and read, take a moment to support MEI and go online and give us a donation at mei.edu. We're very pleased to welcome Paul Danahar today. You had this sort of unique opportunity to observe the Arab Spring firsthand from his perch as the Middle East Bureau Chief for the BBC from 2010 to 2013. And for those of you who didn't have a chance to watch the BBC during that time, its coverage of the Arab Spring and these fast unfolding events was really remarkable for its intelligence and insight and objectivity. I wish I could say the same of some of the American broadcasters. But Paul has written a book which really captures the fervent mood in the Arab world, the mood for change in 2011. And then the challenges that young Egyptians and Libyans of others have faced in their effort to bring real reform to a very deeply entrenched regional order. He draws upon his assignments in Cairo and Libya and Syria and Iraq to weave together personal anecdotes as well as analysis that he derives from his interviews with diplomats and policymakers, to provide greater understanding of these transformations and their implications. And I think what I appreciated most dipping into Paul's book, I did not read all 428 pages, is not only his courage to wade into this maelstrom, but also the amount of historical perspective and context he brings to these remarkable changes. I mean, it's really essential to look at these changes against the backdrop of the decades of authoritarian rule that preceded them. So that is an especially wonderful part of the book. It's an optimistic book, perhaps more optimistic than many are feeling in the region these days, but while never minimizing the problems, he does acknowledge that something unique has happened in the region, which is that Arabs have found their voice and will insist on being heard going forward. So a little more background on Paul. He's worked for the BBC, actually, I meant to ask you, for how many years now?
22.
For 22 years, and during that time served as the BBC's East Asia Bureau Chief and their South Asia Bureau Chief, where he covered the rise and fall and eventual return of the Taliban. He was awarded an MBE, and I had to look this one up, a member of the British Empire Award by Her Majesty the Queen in 2003 for his work as the Baghdad Bureau Chief covering the US-led invasion. And as Middle East Bureau Chief, his team won an Emmy in 2013 for its coverage of the Syria conflict. He's currently the Washington, D.C. Bureau Chief. He's just arrived, and he's looking to make new friends. So get to know him. And with no further ado, I'd like to welcome Paul Danahar.
Thank you very much for coming. You must have Christmas shopping to do, so I do appreciate you making the effort to come and listen to me for an hour. I'll talk for about 25 minutes. I won't go over that, I promise. And then that will give you a chance to ask me questions, and I'll do my best to answer them. So let me start. 3 years ago today, the uncontrollable rage of a generation of young people over the prospect of a wasted life was getting ready to explode. It had been bottling up for years, and it took a single life to release it. That was given by a young man called Mohamed Bouazizi. Mohamed was 26 and a street vendor. He sold fruit and vegetables from a wheelbarrow that he pushed along the dusty streets of the small, poor provincial town in Tunisia called Sidi Bouzid. Around midday on Friday, the 17th of December, 2010, Mohamed walked to the regional council offices. He stood in front of the high gate, doused himself in gasoline, and set himself alight. He did this after his goods and scales were stolen from him by a few corrupt police officials who then beat him up for good measure. It was Bouazizi's individual hopeless reaction to just one of the thousands of petty indignities Tunisians had had to swallow all their lives that set in motion the region's most tumultuous change in more than half a century. When he died 3 years later, 3 weeks later, from the 90% burns that covered his body, the old Middle East died with him. But the realignment of the modern Middle East didn't begin in Tunisia or with young Bouazizi. It began 7 years earlier, and it flowed from an idea that was generated in this city just down the road in Washington to bring democracy to the Middle East. I got my first look at the size of that change on a quiet street in central Baghdad. Two things about it were unusual. It was deserted, and there was a large American tank parked by the side of the road with its barrel pointing straight at me. All I had was a dirty white tablecloth I'd stolen from the Palestine Hotel a few minutes earlier, and I think, in truth, I may have overdone the waving as I headed towards it. But it was one of those moments that drive journalists. This was history, and I was there. The soon-to-be famous statue of Saddam Hussein, which I had watched being built the year before and which was not famous until it fell down, was about to be dragged from that pedestal. In the following years, I would be lucky enough to witness other key events in the Middle East, including the fall of Mubarak in Tahrir Square. I met Colonel Gaddafi when he was alive, and I stood over his body when he was dead. And I got a rather limp handshake from the man who would replace him as the world's most famous dictator, Bashar al-Assad. More importantly, I've had the opportunity to talk to many ordinary people in the Middle East about their hopes and their aspirations and their disappointments, about the many events that flowed from the big bang of revolution. But back on that April morning in 2003, all that was still ahead of me. As I walked up to the tank, a young Marine asked me, "How are you doing?" I said, "Fine." And that was it. I had been liberated. The American occupation of Iraq had begun. The first of the Middle East's great dictators had been overthrown. Saddam Hussein was a center of gravity in the Middle East. When he went, it changed the course of everything else. Iran had a burst of influence after the US toppled regimes in the two nations that had been boxing it in, Afghanistan and Saddam's Iraq. And I was in both of those countries at various stages during those conflicts, before and after the wars, to see that myself. The day before the American-led invasion in Iraq, Iraq was in the Sunni sphere of influence. By the time the Americans left, it was on the Shia side. When the Arab revolts began 8 years later, Saudi Arabia and Qatar were ready to sacrifice the people of Syria to bleed Iran and win the rematch. The Gulf states wanted to counter what they saw as Iran's new friend in Baghdad by helping to ouster its old friend in Damascus. And America's painful experience in Iraq was the defining force behind how it reacted to the civil war in Syria. So what does the Middle East look like 3 years after the first protests erupted? What we do know is that the region is leaving behind many of the old socialist ideologies of Ba'athism and Pan-Arabism and those carried by the founders of Zionism. The Arab Spring has breathed new life into the schism within Islam itself. Sunni and Shia Muslims are facing off against each other in some of the most volatile areas in the region. But even the Sunni powers are divided, with the revolts reigniting old rivalries between the competing ideologies of the Muslim Brotherhood and the kingdoms in the Gulf. There is a growing religious divide in Israel, and I spent the last 4 years living there. Their society is split along ultra-Orthodox, religious Zionist, and secular lines. Across the Arab world, Christians and other minorities wonder if they'll still have a safe place in the new societies being formed. Religion, not nationalism or Arabism, is, in my view, now the dominant force. So how should the world deal with this new Middle East? After lots of criticism and years of academics reading the tea leaves looking for an Obama doctrine, the president himself finally appeared in September to announce a new one for the Middle East at the United Nations General Assembly, and I was very happily there to listen to him deliver it. The problem was it was just like the old one. Oil and Israel are among the core interests, with the menace of Soviet communism replaced with that of Islamic extremism. What was not in the core interest set out by President Obama, the man who, if you remember, offered the people of the Arab world a new beginning from his pulpit in Cairo, were human rights and democracy. Obama told his fellow world leaders, "In the near term, America's diplomatic efforts will focus on two particular issues, Iran's pursuit of nuclear weapons and the Arab-Israeli conflict," because, he said, resolving them can help serve as a foundation for a broader peace. In my view, at the moment, in the immediate aftermath of the Arab Spring revolts, the Obama administration has not made the right choices to focus on. Dealing with Iran does make sense. Its nuclear program is something that this administration knew it was going to have to sort out one way or another. It couldn't be left to fester. The signs have been there all along that President Obama saw the ending the Cold War with Iran as the centerpiece of his foreign policy legacy. The Iranian nuclear issue may be something that decides war and peace in the region, but the Arab-Israeli conflict will not. It is, in fact, increasingly not an Arab-Israeli conflict, but a Palestinian-Israeli conflict, because the Arab world has too much else to worry about. The struggle between Israelis and Palestinians defined much of the old Middle East. It will not define the new one. Three issues should dominate America's diplomatic efforts in the region, in my view. Along with Iran should be Egypt and Syria. The last two will, in the short term, have a much more profound impact on the region than the Palestinian issue. Both of these have at their root the role and reach of religion in societies, and both of these, if handled badly, or frankly, barely handled at all, offer the prospect of a much more troublesome future for America's most important ally in the region, Israel. So I'm going to focus my thoughts today on those two issues, because if I went through the entire book, we'd be here till Christmas Eve, and you wouldn't get your Christmas shopping done. So let me start with Egypt. There was a moment when I thought the new Middle East might turn out to be much, much better than the old one. That moment was on the 23rd of May, 2012, and it took place on dusty, litter-strewn Port Said Street in Cairo. It was the first day of polling in the Egyptian presidential elections. The people waited their turn patiently to do something unprecedented. The Egyptian nation was going to freely elect their leader for the first time in 5,000 years. It wasn't the first time many had stood at the polling station to vote, but it was the first time the ballot boxes were arriving empty. Standing patiently in the queue was a young woman called Manal. She wore a bright purple headscarf tucked into a long black shawar kameez. "Does the revolution end today?" I asked her. "Inshallah, God willing," she said. It did not. Within 1 year, after paying such a high price for their democracy, the Egyptians then sold it cheap. The man who now rules Egypt, General Abdel Fattah al-Sisi, came to power in a coup in July this year. And yes, it really was a coup, though that is a four-letter word that no one in the Obama administration can bring themselves to utter. The man I watched the Egyptian people elect into office, Mohamed Morsi, is in jail. Morsi's leadership came with a wide streak of authoritarianism. He proved to be divisive, incompetent, and hugely unpopular. But he was fairly elected. A way should have been found to use the same democratic process to throw him out. I had stood with the Egyptian people in Tahrir Square the night they celebrated the fall of Mubarak and their aspirations for a true democracy. Many of these people, however reluctantly, also voted for Morsi in the polls. It was the same people who later demanded a military coup to remove him. Many Egyptians think toppling Morsi and having new elections gives them a clean slate. In fact, it has permanently stained their democratic enterprise. The army is back in charge, and that means the labyrinthine bureaucracy that makes up Egypt's deep state, which hid in the shadows in the aftermath of 2011, is solidly back in control. There was no better illustration of the hands-off approach towards the crisis in Egypt than the fact that the EU's foreign policy, Catherine Ashton, was the first foreign diplomat to meet Morsi after his overthrow. Now, the idea since the Suez crisis of the 1950s that Europe would take the lead in Egypt was unthinkable. And then the Secretary of State, John Kerry, used a trip to that other bastion of freedom and human rights, Pakistan, to say that he thought the army in Egypt were restoring democracy when they deposed Morsi. It seemed that if the broad mass of Egyptian people were ready to give up so quickly on their democracy, well, who was the US to argue with them? Nowhere did the folly of youth reveal itself so starkly than in Egypt. Instead of building political alternatives to the two oldest and most powerful institutions in the country, the army and the Muslim Brotherhood, the young revolutionaries spent their energies marching and moaning and fighting among themselves. And it was a thoroughly depressing experience being in Tahrir Square after the revolution, because all you saw were young people standing around arguing and shouting and gluing up the traffic, and the opportunity to build political institutions was completely lost. So when the army, which had assumed power after a bout was overthrown, failed the people, the youth marched against it, forcing elections and elevating the Brotherhood to power. When the Brotherhood also failed, they marched again and they demanded the return of the army. The generals are now once again pulling the strings of a weak caretaker government, and they are pushing through new laws and a new constitution to break the cycle, leaving them in charge. The deep state is using all its influence to position el-Sisi as a potential presidential candidate. Egypt has given strongman rule in the Middle East, which everyone thought had been consigned to the dustbin, another lease of life. Egypt is the biggest and most important Arab state. What happens there shapes the region, and that means it impacts on the world. The brutal suppression of the Muslim Brotherhood members who protested against the coup risks radicalizing a whole new generation of young Islamists. But if the extension of strongman rule hasn't only happened in Egypt, it's also happened in Syria. The only person in the crisis there who is on the up is Bashar al-Assad. It wasn't very long ago that the world leaders were lining up to say, Assad must go. Now they'd all rather like him to stay, at least until the middle of next year, while he decommissions his chemical weapons. And so, after presiding over mass murder, rape, torture, chemical weapons use, and the deaths of more than 100,000 of his people, and the displacement of millions more, he's getting to act all statesmanly, all over again. I think it's hard to underestimate how much of a problem the mess in Syria promises to be for the entire region. Nothing expressed the profound shock caused by the collapse of the old order in the Middle East more clearly than the confused and dithering reaction of the outside world to the war in Syria. It simply did not know what to do. The tone of President Obama's speech in September kind of said, look at the state of this place, as if the US had just popped out to buy some milk and returned to find that everything in the Middle East had been left in a mess. Which is kind of what did happen in 2012, because the Obama administration was so busy getting itself re-elected, it completely dropped the ball on Syria. The wait-and-watch approach in 2011 was understandable, because there was a hope that sanctions might oust Assad. And I met many people from the so-called FSA and the opposition groups who believed by the end of the year he may be out. But by early 2012, it was clear Assad was going to fight to the death, using everything in his arsenal. Helping to arm the moderate opposition then could have been decisive. Not choosing to arm the moderate opposition then has proved to be equally decisive. Everybody missed the train on this crisis, a diplomat in Damascus told me a few months ago. The UN did not show up, the Europeans and the Americans did not show up, they left it all in the hands of the Arab League. Then the Arab League started messing it up from day one. They are the ones who radicalized it. In the absence of an alternative plan from the Western powers, the Gulf states did what they always do when they are confronted with a complex political dilemma. They opened up their wallets and they threw money at it. The Gulf states and the Western powers may have been on the same side, but their instincts were poles apart. The United States saw much of the early stages of the Arab revolts through the prism of its impact on Israel and oil. It didn't have a plan for the new Middle East, so it defaulted back to the ideas it used to manage the old one. The US sought stability in the region. But the Gulf states, once they were sure they'd sorted out stability at home, set about shaking things up everywhere else. They were much quicker to recognize that stability, for the sake of stability, was pointless at that stage. The region was in flux. Instead of trying to contain it, they decided to steer it in the direction that they wanted. And so began another round in the decades-long proxy war between the conservative Shia power, Iran, and the most conservative Sunni power, Saudi Arabia. You better answer that. It could be your wife asking for a present for Christmas. The Saudis saw in all the turmoil... Oh, okay, then you're okay. The Saudis saw in all the turmoil an opportunity to dramatically weaken Tehran's influence in the region. That opportunity was to be found in Syria. I was told by UN officials in Damascus that at times last year, as the UN called for peace and reconciliation, Saudi Arabia and Qatar were deliberately sabotaging local ceasefires negotiated by UN monitors. In a parallel with the early stages of the war in Afghanistan against the Soviets in the 1980s, the outside funding for the opposition in Syria first came from wealthy individuals in the Gulf. Money and arms were handed over to the head of each Syrian opposition group. But then, two relatives leading an opposition group found out that if they split into two groups, they could both get money. The decentralized funding model encouraged division within the opposition, just as the United Nations was trying to encourage the opposite. It wasn't intentional, a UN official told me in New York, but it was very reckless. When the only alternative funding from Syrian businessmen sympathetic to the pro-democracy rebels dried up, the only regular and reliable funds came from the Gulf. And that meant moderate groups not only ran out of arms and ammunition, they also lost their young fighters to the Islamist groups who did have resources. I have lost count of how many times I spoke to people inside Lebanon who were going back in to fight and had less men than they had when they came out. And that was because they hadn't run away and they hadn't been shot. They'd just been bribed away with better guns, better ammunition, better food, and a bit of pocket money to keep their families going while they went to war. But let's be clear. Saudi Arabia and Qatar, and more recently the Kuwaitis, are meddling in Syria for thoroughly selfish reasons. Freedom, democracy, and human rights have absolutely nothing to do with why they are arming the rebels. A UN official in New York told me, the Saudi government are more concerned about Iran. That's their biggest monster in the equation. What happens afterwards when it comes to Syria is almost immaterial. The only thing that is certain in Syria is who is losing. The Syrian people are losing. They are losing their lives, their homes, their wealth. Their children are losing their childhoods. The Syrians are also losing Syria, because the longer this goes on, the more society is losing what little sense of identity it has. It is looking increasingly unlikely that Syria as a country will remain in its present form. The Islamist groups seem to be trying to create a statelet of their own in the north of the country. Importantly, for now, they seem to be trying to avoid many of the mistakes of alienating and murdering the local population, which was what the trademark was of Al-Qaeda in Iraq, and which eventually led to the local people there turning against them. After the US had spent more than a decade at war with Al-Qaeda in the region, the conflict in Syria led to the unedifying spectacle of America and Osama bin Laden's followers being on the same side, albeit with starkly different visions for the post-conflict era. To have left the way for Al-Qaeda to reconstitute itself on the border of America's most important ally, Israel, is a massive failure, in my view, of US foreign policy. That money would start flowing from the Gulf states to back jihadist groups fighting in Syria was entirely predictable. It was also easy to move them there. They just jumped in a car and drove across the border from Iraq. The Arab Spring was at first an ideological catastrophe for groups like Al-Qaeda. It fundamentally undermined one of the key planks of the global jihad philosophy, which was that the West will not allow peaceful change, so it must be dealt a mortal blow before work can begin on a model Islamic society. The chaos in Syria and the coup in Egypt has given groups like Al-Qaeda another chance. The first year of the conflict in Syria saw the West trying to negotiate Assad out of the country. From the second year, once it was clear Assad was not going to go in a matter of months, and that there was no appetite among the US public for military engagement, the Obama administration sought to stop the violence spilling out elsewhere. The US has not really been trying to resolve the situation in Syria. It has been trying to contain it. Is there anything that stayed the same in this crisis, you may ask yourself? Well, there is. The political opposition in exile, the Syrian National Coalition, which wanders around international capitals attending conferences and making speeches, is still not leading anyone. It barely has control of the delegates in the room with it, let alone the fighters in the field. In fact, one gathering in Cairo literally descended into a brawl. They were irrelevant at the start of the crisis, and they are irrelevant today. So there you have it. There is some continuity in the Middle East after all. It is for this reason that around a dozen of the most effective groups of rebel fighters in Syria have said they will no longer recognize the SNC. So that means if we do see another attempt at starting a peace process for Syria with Geneva II early next year, any deal will be pretty worthless because no one in the room is actually representing the people doing the most effective fighting against the regime on the ground. The battle between the Sunni and Shia forces in the Middle East will continue beyond the outcome of the war in Syria. The more the Gulf states and Iran turn the Syrian crisis into a proxy war over God, the more that sectarian poison will flow out into the region. If the Sunni and Shia are seen to be slaughtering each other in Syria, that will impact on communal relations in countries not directly connected to the conflict. America and its allies may be able to contain the physical war within Syria's borders, but it's already clear they will not be able to contain its influence on the wider region. The big question being asked in Washington and in the Middle East is, does a deal on Iran and their nuclear program mean progress on resolving the civil war in Syria? It's an important question. And when he was asked it last month, John Kerry had a simple answer. Well, I don't know. I mean, honestly, I don't think anybody has any idea. That would depend on a lot of things, one step at a time here. The problem is that this one step at a time approach looks less like caution and more like the Obama administration is making up foreign policy in the Middle East as it goes along. George W. Bush led America into Iraq without a plan. Barack Obama kept America out of Syria without a plan. Not acting is not passive. Not acting is a decision that has consequences. The Obama administration made a mistake allowing the untried and undemocratic Gulf states to run the show at the beginning. The opportunity to stop the descent into bloodlust has been lost. There can now only be a policy of containment. The warring sides will have to exhaust themselves into a solution in the same way that people watched Yugoslavia exhaust itself into a solution in Europe. In the past, conflicts in the Middle East were primarily about land. In the future, they will often be over the perceived will of God. No one can say for sure how the region will evolve in the coming years. All that can be said, in my view, is that religion will increasingly play a bigger part in people's political choices, whether they are Muslims or Jews or Christians. People will want their societies to reflect their values, but their politicians will be judged by their performance, not their preaching. If they don't provide good jobs and functioning public services, they will be booted out. I suspect that even in Egypt, the people will again soon lose patience with the army, because the army will also probably fail again. This is a new Middle East because the people of the region now have a voice. They will not go back to sitting on their couch as passive observers. And so, whether their leaders like what they have to say or not, the world after the Arab Spring means they are going to have to listen to them. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Paul. And it was nice starting the talk with reflections on Mohamed Bouazizi. You've thrown a lot out there for the audience to talk about. I'd like to see if there are any questions. Individuals.
Tom Dine with a variety of organizations. Again, I apologize for the phone.
It's okay. I've done it many times myself.
I know. And I hate it every time. I noticed, I had a quick glance at your book, and the old Middle East, the Levant particularly, after World War I, Sykes-Picot, and it was a scandal then, and it's still a scandal. At least it doesn't work very well in terms of the European idea of a nation state. Is there a post Sykes-Picot in your new Middle East? The only two things I can see that could come out of this that are new, but I don't think are different, a Palestinian state, a Kurdish state, and that's it.
I think by default, the way the war is going, that Syria will not remain Syria in the same form that it is. I think we will end up with a statelet, perhaps not a recognized statelet, but if you look at the way that the ISIS and the different groups that are fighting up there, they're not fighting to get down to Damascus. They're fighting to clear territory. They are fighting to take a big chunk of the north of Syria and hold on to it. And that's what they've always done, right from the beginning. That was where they put their effort. That's what they were fighting for. They were fighting for turf to hang on to create a little area all of their own. So I don't believe it's going to be easy to put Syria back together again. When I went to Syria in 2011, people talked quite hopefully about the prospects of getting it together again. When I went back into early 2012, people talked about, you know, we still can put Syria back together again. When I went back this summer, people just said, you know, we've kind of lost it. So I think we will see Syria change. I think, and the effect there will mean that we probably will get a Kurdish entity, and that may therefore put pressure on Iraq. Do I think we're going to get a Palestinian state? Honestly, I really can't see it. If you look at the way that Israel is moving, the interesting thing about Israel and living there is that in many parts of the world, it's the young people that push their elders to be radical, to change, to kind of compromise and reach agreements. The young generation in Israel is still incredibly traumatized by the Second Intifada. They simply do not trust Palestinians. And the big problem, again, is that they've grown up not knowing any Palestinians in the West Bank because there's this big wall built between them. So you now have two peoples growing up in isolation who increasingly only interact with each other either through memory of not being able to get on a number 7 bus or a number 5 bus in case it blew up, or if you're a Palestinian, you only ever interact with an Israeli in a green uniform holding a gun. And so I think the prospects of being able to come to a negotiated agreement are slim, partly because of that, and partly because if you look at the aspirations of people like Naftali Bennett, they want to take 60% of the West Bank. They want Area C. And I came to his lecture 2 weeks ago, or rather his Q&A a couple of weeks ago. And he was talking about, you know, we can get along with the Palestinians living in our area, in Area C. That 60%, he didn't say it was 60%, but that 60% of the country, of the West Bank, sorry. If that happens, then there is no prospect of a Palestinian state. And I don't see any kind of momentum for stopping that. So the funny thing about Sykes was he pretended to speak Turkish and he pretended to speak Arabic and he couldn't do either one, and he kind of pulled the wool over everybody's eyes. So it was almost kind of destined for failure. I can't see anything much more kind of hopeful coming out of the present state of play.
Mohammed Al-Husseini from the Arab League.
Hello. I hope you were here for the whole thing.
But I didn't like your position on the Arab League. But anyway, I will. Yeah, you said that they messed up from the first day.
They were messing up for years, really messed it up.
I will elaborate anyway.
Please do.
Just because really, to my surprise as an Arab, and I represent the Arab League, originally I'm a Saudi, to my surprise that the Arab League took many positions really which are unprecedented.
And
even to the United States.
They did.
Surprised to the extent that we signed a memorandum of understanding of cooperation between the Arab League, and I said for the first time. As you remember, you know well, I am sure, since you have been there, the Arab League suspended the membership of Libya and Syria. They imposed sanctions and supported the sanctions, which I am still attending conferences on that here and there. They also supported the NATO strike. And even some Arabian warships were there cooperating with the NATO.
They did that too.
I think all of these, you cannot say that
My argument would be that the Arab League, and it's actually, it's been reflected by a lot of the conversations I've had with people in various foreign departments of governments, the Arab League kind of got body snatched by Saudi Arabia and Qatar. I used to speak to people in a lot of countries who were going to Arab League summits, and they would say, you know, these guys, they just bulldoze their way through these meetings. I mean, they've got loads of money and we're in a bit of a terrible shape, and they just hammer through what they want. So yeah, I mean, I remember writing in 2011 that the Arab League, as you know, for the first time in its history, has begun to be useful. Because it was being useful. But I think what people failed to recognize early on, what was happening was the policy of the Gulf was driving the policy of the Arab League. I don't think that there was a broad policy that was being run by the Arab League because the rest of the members were too weak. If you remember, the last meeting of the Arab League, I think before the Arab Spring, was in Libya. You look at the kind of people that were in the Arab League then and their agenda now, I'd say it was very different. But we're not going to agree on this.
Yeah, but
well, that's okay.
On the name of the Arab Spring, and your book is the latest, maybe, in on the Arab Spring, although they don't call it anymore Arab
Spring. I wrote about that in the book. I explained why I called it the Arab Spring. I mean, I said, you know, you could have called it the Arab Awakening, but that was used in the 1950s to describe what went on then. You could have called it, some people called it the Islamic Spring, some people called it the Sunni Spring, some called it the Islamic Winter. The Arab Spring was what everyone was kind of using as a more generic term, and I wrote the book for the wider public, and so I accept that the Arab Spring is not a fantastic name because it's not very springy in the Middle East at the moment, but it was the most widely used term, and that's why I stuck with it. But if you, I think it's on page 4, you'll find my apology for using that phrase.
Okay. Tom, you can introduce yourself, please.
Good morning. I'm Tom Lippman. I'm an adjunct scholar here at the Middle East, and I was a correspondent out there more years ago than I care to talk. I would like to ask you about a country I didn't hear you mention, and that's Jordan. How fragile is Jordan, and how is all this swirling around Jordan going to affect that country?
I had a conversation with someone very senior in the Israeli army about 4 or 5 months ago, and he said to me, we were having a conversation about Jordan, and he said to me, God save the king. I think everyone's worried about Jordan. I mean, Jordan has always been a fragile country, and the idea, I mean, that's, I think we can look at the fact that they've kept all of their refugees right up north rather than allowing the Syrian refugees to kind of come into the country, which is a reflection, I think, of how nervous they are. They're all, the leadership in Jordan is already worried about the influence of, you know, the Palestinians, if you, for want of a better phrase, within their society that are running the country, running the business areas of the country. The country is extremely fragile. I think it's slightly less fragile than it was because I think the push back on the Brotherhood in Egypt has meant that the Brotherhood in Jordan is slightly less, has a slightly less kind of effervescence about it. So I think that's made them feel slightly more comfortable. I also think that the fact that there is so much instability in the region means that the people that might be hassling the king and particularly having a go at him and using his wife basically as a means to give him a hard time. She's been the figure of a lot of grief privately within Jordanian society. That has tended to go away now because I think people see things as being so fragile that they are willing to basically pull together and see this through because it is a terrible storm for Jordan. I think in some ways it's got better because there was a period when I think perhaps Assad would have lashed out at Jordan as the easiest place to lash out at. I think Assad's feeling kind of comfortable at the moment. So I think the problem with Jordan is it just keeps doing this. It's up and it's down and it's up and it's down. And I think it will probably survive because everybody wants it to survive. Nobody wants it to be a big hole in Jordan. Even the right wing of Israel wants it to survive because they want to kind of take what they leave left behind of a Palestinian state and say, you look after it. So it's in everyone's interest, I think, to keep Jordan in some kind of reasonable shape.
Hi, my name is Maria Saab. I'm Maria Saab. I work with the Middle East Task Force at the New America Foundation. Actually, this was kind of piggybacking off your question about the countries in the midst of the conflict that are not necessarily in conflict, like Lebanon and Jordan. What happens to, what's your vision for countries like Lebanon, so close to the border of Syria, that, like Jordan, are getting, you know, hundreds of thousands of refugees each day and have a small area between Hezbollah and the conflict in Syria?
Funny thing, the Lebanese used to joke to the Syrians when they used to go to Syria for refuge and stay with friends and family. They used to say to me, if you ever have a war, you can come and stay with us. And they never really expected that to happen, but that is what's happened. I think the interesting thing about Lebanon, every time I've gone to Lebanon, and I mean before the Arab Spring, they were ready for the country to fall apart. You know, it was either going to be Israel or it was going to be Hezbollah or, you know, it was going to be one thing or the other. I think the reality of Lebanon is it will always be on the edge, but I think the effect of the civil war means it will probably always pull itself back again. I think the civil war is just seared into people's memories. I think it's too fresh for people to go down that road again. It's not in Hezbollah's interest. I mean, Hezbollah is pretty powerful in Lebanon. If they had a civil war, they may end up less powerful. There are obviously Sunni groups that are trying to agitate there. But again, I just think the Lebanese people will they'll pull back from the brink. I just don't think they want to go down that road again because, you know, everyone, it's still very, very fresh in living memory. So I counterintuitively, perhaps, I don't think that Lebanon, despite the being perhaps parked next to the worst place in the world, is going to fall apart. I just think they've got too much, they've just suffered too much to do it again. We have to let this guy talk because he keeps waving his hand.
Hello, I'm Bill Goodfellow at the Center for International Policy.
Hi.
I think you're being a little hard on Barack Obama.
Well, someone had to say that.
Yeah, I know, I know.
And I am in Washington.
Yeah,
I was
going
to say something nice.
Arrived, and what you will discover, I think, is there's very little enthusiasm here for military adventures in
exactly.
the Middle East. You look at Iraq. Just yesterday, 77 people died in sectarian fighting. I was in Afghanistan last month. That's certainly not going well.
Mm.
Even Libya, where we didn't have boots on the ground, I don't think the Obama administration said, whoa, that really worked well. Let's do that again.
No, I think Libya was actually an anomaly in their policy rather than setting a precedent for their policy.
But nevertheless, I think that it wasn't as if he could have said, okay, well, I'll go in. There's a lot of resistance in Congress
and
elsewhere.
I'm not suggesting that he should have done, to be honest with you.
So anyway, I'm just saying that...
I take your point and I...
There's very little enthusiasm for it in the US.
I think the problem here, the thing that I've identified here since I've been here, which was I've only been to America a few times and I came to interview people and research some stuff for the book. What's really obvious to me is that everyone just assumes after Iraq that if you get involved in any way, it's just a slippery slope into another war with a bunch of ungrateful people in a country you don't really want to be in, and you'll get nothing out of it. So why bother? I completely get that. I mean, I really do. My argument is more that there was an opportunity in 2012, early 2012, to basically manage what was getting to the opposition. Manage some kind of structure so that there was an opposition and make sure that if money was going to go in, it went to the right people. Kind of what they're trying to do now by managing the money that the Saudis are putting in and telling the Qataris to just kind of lay off a little bit with these guys, but we'll let you put money over there. If they'd have done that in 2012, I think it would have changed the game. I'm not talking about America should have got involved militarily, that it should have been creating no-fly zones or anything like that. I think if they'd have put, you know, If there had been the capacity to create some kind of buffer zone in the north, simply because people were armed and capable of having a buffer zone in the north, it would have encouraged defections from the Syrian army. The big problem in Syria was that if you ran away with your family, you might get your kids and your wife out, but your entire extended family would just disappear into a torture chamber. So unless you could take a whole chunk of people out, you were basically saying that, you know, Aunt Flo and Uncle Bob were going to die. And that meant that people were just incredibly reluctant to jump. And it also meant that the people sitting in the middle, which were often the Sunni businessmen and the Christians and the other minorities, were just waiting to see which way this was going. And because there seemed to be no momentum from anyone to kind of show which direction it was going in, people just sat back. So I accept it would have been utterly foolish to put boots on the ground and utterly foolish to try and set up a no-fly zone there, and nobody would have accepted it. But I do think that there was an opportunity in 2012 to make a difference, and I simply think people kind of were busy doing something else, which you can understand if you're a politician, you want to get back in again. But I think it was a real massive missed opportunity. So I'm talking more about that. But I do think that there has been a kind of ad hoc approach to the Middle East ever since. I mean, you know, there was a ridiculous situation earlier this year where you've got Obama saying, we don't do pinpricks, and we've got Kerry saying, it's going to be really, really tiny. And you kind of think, come on, guys, have a conversation before you talk to the media. You know, so that's where I think that there's been an incredible lack of leadership or an incredible lack of clarity, perhaps, in what vision they have. Because whether you like it or not, you know, the Europeans are not going to come to anybody's rescue. I mean, Europeans have just been rubbish. I mean, you know, they've been out of the game for such a long time. The reality is that if you're waiting for the Europeans to sort out any mess, we can't even sort out Europe. So we're really not going to get involved anywhere else and do anything particularly exciting. There's no one here from the EU, is there? Otherwise, I really am in trouble again. Nope. Okay, good. They can go online and hassle me later. Anybody else?
You talked about an opportunity in 2012. An opportunity in 2012 to fund the moderate opposition.
Well, to moderate, certainly channel the funding that was coming in.
My question is just, do you think there's any element of wishful thinking in the West that there ever was a moderate opposition to help? I'm not convinced that that ever existed, that that was ever viable. We wished there was.
No, I would disagree with you. I met a lot of people in Syria, and they had a vision for their country. And they actually had a vision that included the Alawites. I think the problem now is that it's increasingly difficult to get anybody to reconcile themselves with the other communities because the level of brutality has just been staggering. There was an opportunity, I think. There was a moderate opposition. The Syrians are pretty moderate. I mean, you know, this is not a bunch of crazies. I remember going to Syria, Damascus, in late 2010 when I got to meet Assad. And, you know, it was like Paris, but without the arrogance. You know, it was really nice. You know, people with nice wine, nice food, lovely buildings, lots of really interesting people. And I think, you know, frankly, if you went around Syria in, you know, before the war, there were lots of very moderate people. They could have walked straight out of, the Burberry shop down the road. There was an opportunity there, I think. I think the problem was that you had all these groups on the run from Afghanistan, from Iraq, not knowing where to go. And suddenly you just gave them this chance to kind of get together again and gave them a vision because they'd lost their vision. You know, Bin Laden was dead. Al-Qaeda really as a kind of entity had begun to fall apart. They'd messed up in Iraq. They got kind of, you know, a comeback, the return of part two in Syria. And I think that really did change the game. Hi.
Hello. Kareem Wasfi, I'm the former principal conductor of the Iraqi National Symphony, but I had some interesting background in politics.
You should not
well.
Use a microphone then.
precisely, if the acoustics allows. Now, thank you very much for sharing your vision and everything. Why, if we were all overwhelmed, or if we are all overwhelmed with these situations here and or the Middle East in general, why are we so? Wasn't it obvious or palpable for lots of long, long years that this might be an inevitable end of certain status of things within the whole area over there, to include even the western part, except for Morocco, which I want to ask you, what would your take on that would be? Why is everybody so surprised with the what we have reached in the Middle East? And do you think this was part of the ongoing possible obvious changes that will still be leading to more dramatic changes within the area and especially the Mediterranean, I mean, Southern Europe?
I think that after the Arab Spring, there was a story in the, I think it was the New York Times, which someone in the White House obviously spun, talking about how, you know, there'd been this kind of precedent and they'd had this group together to get ready for what they could see was going to be a big, you know, change in the Middle East. And I spoke to someone who knew all about that. And, you know, there was an idea there, and it frankly got ground into internecine warfare between the State Department and the Pentagon, and it didn't really go anywhere. So people did kind of pretend to be a bit wiser after the event. I think it was inevitable the change would happen. What people didn't know was how it would happen, and people genuinely didn't want it to happen because the policy for the Middle East was, yeah, guys, look, we know it's kind of miserable living in Egypt, and yeah, you do get beaten up quite a lot, and yeah, I know you vote for people, but the boxes arrive full, so it's not really much point in putting your cross on it. But it worked for us, you know, it did work. I mean, it worked for the Barbara Bodine, who's former ambassador to Yemen. I interviewed her for my book, and she said, I don't know anyone that liked dealing with dictators, but there is a perverse simplicity to it. And I think that's true. It's you just have to go to one guy. And if you get that one guy on board, everything else kind of happens. I mean, it happens in a slightly incompetent way, but it happens. I mean, there's an idea there, and it follows through. So I don't think there was any real ambition to change things in a big bang. I think there was hope that things may begin to slowly change. But when that slow change started to happen and George Bush called for more democracy and opening up the economy, all it meant was that the cronies got more money. And the people that came up and said, well, I'll stand for election, ended up in jail, which put other people off from doing it. So I think it was a surprise to everyone. I think it wasn't necessarily a surprise that something was going to happen. I think the thing that really changed it in many ways, I don't think it's the reason for the Arab Spring, but I think what made it a little quicker perhaps, was social media, because it was the first time you could organize without needing to have a leader. And it was the first time that you could have an organization where you couldn't go lock somebody up or bribe them or chase them off and then kill the movement dead. So I think, you know, when you're in Tahrir Square or you're wandering around the streets, people just looked at their phones for the brief period where the phones were working. But, you know, they were looking at each other and going, oh, my God, this has happened, or that's happened, you know. And so people communicated with each other in a way that didn't require a kind of Nelson Mandela figure. I think the tragedy after the Arab Spring is that they didn't have any leaders, because then nobody took charge of what came afterwards and said, right, guys, let's get organized, let's provide an alternative. And I think particularly that's true in Egypt, where you had the Brotherhood and you had the army, and nobody built a kind of third path. No, I mean, with the best will in the world, and I mean no disrespect to Mr. El-Baradei, I never once heard his name mentioned during the uprising in Egypt. Not once by anyone. He came to the square once, he found it a bit unsettling, and he left rather quickly. You know, he was never going to be this figure that was going to unify people. People kind of saw him as a foreigner that popped into Cairo, wandered around a bit, and then left. And that's exactly what he did at the end of it. He'd never had that kind of leadership potential. But the West, because we kind of like something simple to kind of hang our ideas on, we were all going, he's the man. He's going to do it. He was never going to do it. He was never, ever going to do it. But, you know, people kept pushing false hopes on this guy. And so when people on the outside were saying, you know, let's try and build an alternative, they tried to use him. You know, and with the best will in the world, he was never going to do it. Egyptians were never going to buy into him. And, you know, as soon as there was the first sign of trouble, he's off, frankly. I mean, look, I think if you look at what happened in South Africa, where I spent a couple of years, if you look at the range of leaders that came out of the struggle in South Africa, not just Mandela, but Oliver Tambo and Steve Biko and all these people, you kind of think, where are they in the Middle East? Where is the kind of, you know, the generation of new leaders that might actually take people somewhere? It's kind of depressing.
Well, how would you explain that dearth of leadership, let's say in a country like Egypt, where you're encountering revolutionaries, you know, young revolutionaries in the square on a regular basis?
My problem with many of the young revolutionaries was that the people that could actually have kind of leveraged the fame that they got out of the Middle East into something, went off and wrote books, you know, did chat shows. Basically, I think that the difference in South Africa, perhaps with the Middle East, was that in South Africa, there was something that unified everybody. There was an easy thing to fight against, and it was about you. It was about you very personally. What the dictatorships did, which also the South Africans tried to do, the white South Africans, they tried to divide people on a tribal basis, which worked in many areas, but there were big tribes. So eventually, there was still a big group of people that were fighting against them. In the Middle East, they kind of decimated civil society. They just made it such that you couldn't trust anyone. You couldn't trust your neighbor. You couldn't trust someone not to be an informer. You couldn't trust a policeman down the road. In South Africa, if someone was black, there was a good chance they were on your side, frankly. If you were in the Middle East, you just didn't know who to trust. And I think that meant that no one, you know, if you did start kind of trying to build something, someone in your group was a spy, you get banged up. The opportunity would be lost. Sorry? Morocco. Actually, I spoke to someone from the Moroccan government recently, privately. I think we had the kind of measured attempt at reform in Morocco.
You mentioned Jordan because of Israel, but what about Morocco?
Well, I think Morocco, I mean, Morocco was, I think the king was quite clever in Morocco. He kind of, before people went mad on the streets, he kind of said, well, I'll change things a little bit. And he moved things around and kind of reorganized the kind of flower arrangements and kept things going and kept people giving an aspiration that things were going to change. And they were changing slowly. And then the Brotherhood got kicked out in Egypt. And then the Brotherhood got a bit nervous in Morocco. And that meant that the pace of reform has slowed down a little bit. And the king and his people have got a little bit more control over things. I think Morocco is probably going in the right direction. I think the pace of change will slow down now. And I think people are kind of nervous about what's happened in the Arab world. So they kind of don't really want fast change, because everywhere there's been fast change, it's kind of gone a bit wrong at the moment. So I think Morocco will get there in the end, I think. The good thing about being, you know, some countries nobody wants to fight over. I think Tunisia will get there in the end, because, you know, who wants to fight over Tunisia? I mean, the French didn't even want to fight over Tunisia. They gave it up. They went after Algeria. And I think as long as nobody wants to fight over you, I mean, nobody from outside wants to fight over you, you kind of leaves you in a better situation. So don't have oil, I think, is the motto of my...
Hello, my name is Julia Talib, and I'm Syrian. And I just want to say, like, I agree with you. I believe that we have the majority of the opposition in Syria are moderate, and they were marginalized from the very beginning. And my question to you is, I'm still hopeful, a little bit, not necessarily hopeful, but I still think that we could find a resolution to the Syrian conflict, and this would take the U.S. and Russia to agree on regional influence, and they believe they can still influence their allies to basically opposition and the regime to share power with the regime. I know this sounds outrageous for some, but I think if we're really thinking of a resolution, we like it or not, it seems like we have to share power. And so I just would like to ask if you still think it's possible to reach an agreement or resolution over Syria.
I think it would depend on the strength of voices like yours, to be honest with you. I mean, there will be a big chunk of people in the north who, I mean, the reality was that there's many people, particularly in the north of Syria, who I think, given the chance to roll the clock back, would do it. Not because they love Assad, but they love their kids. And the thing about that I found being in Iraq, for example, I mean, in the run-up to Iraq in late 2002, a colleague of mine said, Saddam is a bastard, but he's our bastard. And so, you know, they wanted him to go, but they didn't want someone else to come in and change and rule them. But then as it got worse and worse, people just wanted their kids to be able to walk home from school. I mean, when it comes right down to it, we all care about our kids more than anything else. And the problem in Syria now is that all people want are their kids to be safe. They want them to be fed. They want them to be get medical care. They want them to be able to get clean water. And I think there's a situation now where many people like yourself, I imagine a couple of years ago, if someone had said to you, let's compromise with Assad, you'd have probably shouted at them. And now you're saying, look, my country's falling apart. So I think the opportunity, the willingness to compromise from the opposition side is probably there. But I think Assad kind of thinks he's winning because he's not losing. And that's why he doesn't feel like he needs to. But the point is, who's going to make him compromise? I think the Russians jumped on board when John Kerry had his epiphany in London about getting rid of chemical weapons, or rather that being the way to kind of not get bombed. The Russians were going to sign up to that. I mean, everyone was going to sign up. Nobody wants, you know, nuclear chemical weapons running around in a country where there's a civil war. But do the Russians want to go further than that? Probably not. The Russians were really, really upset, as were the Chinese, about Libya. I mean, it went beyond Libya. It was more about kind of Russian ego. And suddenly they felt like they'd been completely hoodwinked. That matters. You know, Russians don't like to be made fools of. And I think there was a genuine sense in Moscow that, you know, you guys have just stitched us up. And we're not, you know, we're important. You know, you're acting like we're not important and we're not going to put up with that again. And that's why I think it's kind of silly, but I think that is actually quite a big chunk of Russia's reaction. We're not going to be made fools of again by you guys. And I think that makes it quite hard. I'm not being very optimistic, am I? It's a bit optimistic.
Yes, it is, as I mentioned in my places. Introduction. I want to just close on a quick question. We have the BBC Middle East Bureau Chief here. You covered Syria. You oversaw the team that won an Emmy covering Syria. Can you talk a little bit about the challenges of covering Syria today in 2013? Our crews going into the north, and I'm talking about in the rebel areas, and what is the impact of this lack of coverage in terms of our comprehension of the state of the crisis?
We do send people into the north. We have been from the beginning. We were in Babar Amr when, actually we were the first people to go into Babar Amr, although we went back in again when other people went in and some of our colleagues were killed. We decided that at the beginning of the Syrian conflict that we would invest very heavily in it because we felt it was important. We were going in and out more than anybody else because we invested in it. We send in very small, very experienced teams. We separate them up, so we have teams going into Damascus and we have teams going into the north, and we don't mix them up because, to be honest with you, if you have a Syrian stamp in your passport and that passport is seen by someone in the opposition, there's a good chance you may get into a lot of trouble because nobody trusts anybody else. The real danger, I think, in Syria is that we've had an awful lot of kids having a crack at covering their first war. It happened in Libya. I remember being, you know, on the front lines in Libya, in places like Misrata and Ajdabia, and seeing people just out of college who were utterly clueless, running around without flak jackets, often running in the wrong direction, and, you know, just about not getting themselves killed. Syria has happened, you know, wars that are too close to where people, you know, wars that are easy to get to become a big problem. Because what happens is, often, people don't want to, a lot of news organizations don't want to invest in having someone sitting there day in, day out, waiting for someone to be interested in the story. So they pull their big people out and they rely on freelancers. And the freelancers are normally very inexperienced, very young, and very badly paid, which means they can't afford insurance, they can't afford flak jackets, they can't afford thoriophones to be able to make telephone conversations back to base, and sometimes they just disappear. We don't do that. We do not use freelancers in Syria. We've never used freelancers in Syria. We won't use freelancers in Syria. We use our own people. We send in people like myself. You know, before I can go anywhere, I have to go on a proper paramedic type course to learn how to look after my colleagues. We only send people that have been in war zones before, like myself. I wasn't allowed into a war zone unless I was part of a team that had been in one before. We do a lot of training, and so do all the big organizations. It's hard, it's expensive, it's dangerous. We will continue to do it. I think the problem now is, at the beginning, you could get into the opposition, you couldn't get into Damascus. Now the government's wised up. Now actually it's not too hard getting into Damascus, but we have a similar situation that we had in Iraq, that we've now become targets. Before Iraq, we were never targets. It was interesting. I was in Baghdad when an American missile landed in the middle of a civilian area, and it was an appalling sight. We used to have minders in Iraq, but sometimes you just drove off and you left them behind because they were often having a sleep in the afternoon. And we got to this place, and there were pieces of people everywhere. There were pieces of people hanging from the trees. There were pieces of people in the gutters. There was blood everywhere. And I turn up from the BBC, which is the British Broadcasting Company, a corporation, and we were involved in helping blow those people up. Now, you'd imagine that I kind of think, you know, if England or Britain had a war with someone, let's say, I don't know, Germany again, and then the Germans dropped a great big bomb in the middle of London, and a German walked up to someone and said, "I'd like to ask you how you feel about what's this?" They get torn apart. And yet in Iraq, these were people without, there were no minders around, there were no security around, these were ordinary people, and they could have torn us apart, and they didn't. They could make, I think, you know, people talked about the kind of civilization. I think it's the ultimate act of civilization that you can distinguish between the individual and the country that they're coming from, and be willing to listen and understand what that person's got to say and where they're coming from. And I think that has been lost after the war in Iraq. Journalists are now targets. We're targets in Syria. It does make it hard. That was a long answer. Sorry about that. But anyway. All
right. Well, it was. On that note, we must end. I'd like to invite you all to come up and buy Paul's book, which we'll be signing. It's selling for $25. We take cash, credit cards, checks, whatever you want. So
lunch and
please join me in thanking Paul.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
Thanks a lot.
Interesting. Yep.